Hello and welcome to SIMSO Sessions, the safe space to share your stories. Tonight we are talking to one of your favorite, my favorite, doctors, performers, comedians, Dr. Michael Abrams. He's in our big chair tonight. First though, folks, we cannot believe we are one show away from our season finale and a very, very special one it will be. As is always the case, we want to thank you for your love for and your loyalty to this show. I'm very overwhelmed by your feedback online, on the road, everywhere I go. So we're starting our show tonight with some Sim Soul feedback. Your thoughts, here they are.
Thank you for this show that you have brought to us. Trust me, it has been a really great stepping stone for me. It has motivated me. It has lifted my spirit. There were times that I might be going through some situation, and because of stories that people come on the show and share, it has given me a new perspective of life, looking forward to things. And I must say, this has been a great season, and I look forward to the next one.
I just want to say, you know, I enjoy watching the show. It keeps me really connected to Jamaica, even though I'm not there, you know. I really enjoy every session, different topics, keep me motivated, it inspired me just to know that I have something to connect with the land of my birth, even though I'm not there physically.
Hey Simone, shérif depuis Paris. Je suis un grand, grand, grand fan de ton émission. J'ai hâte pour la prochaine session qui arrive. Hey. Allez, 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 allez. J'espère que ça va être une bombe. J'ai hâte. Allez, bien sûr.
Just wanted to let you know that I enjoy watching your show so much. You have such powerful and inspiring guests with such heartwarming stories. And I just love hearing about the success that and the challenges they were able to overcome. Can't wait to hear what you have in store for next season.
I enjoyed watching Sim Soul Session. I look forward for every season. You are an inspiration to many. I enjoyed every bit of your shows. Your messages it brings to others, to Jamaica and the world. Thank God for your program. Your show brings laughter, it brings tears, it brings joy.
Sim Soul Sessions means the world to me. It came at a breaking point of my life when I needed it the most. Each episode became a therapy session, literally. I've experienced healing, breakthrough, and total mental deliverance. Thank you, Lori, for producing this amazing and inspiring broadcast. Simone, you are a visionary, a glory carrier, and a world changer. Continue to do God's work here on earth. I love you. We love you. Thank you, Simone, and thank you, Sim Soul Sessions.
Thank you so much, everybody. We are so grateful to have you as part of our Sim Soul Sessions family. When we come back, one more family member is here. It is time for Dr. Michael Abrams. Stay with us. We'll be right back with more. Welcome back to the show, everybody. So Dr. Michael Abrams is an OBGYN. He's an outspoken advocate. He's a performer, a comedian, but more importantly, just a human being who's been very open about his struggles with depression, which he says he's now at a point that he can manage and not allow it to control his life. How did he get there? Well, tonight he's going to share more about that in our big chair, which he, you know, does, as with everything else he does, to help somebody else. Hi.
Thanks for having me.
How are you?
I'm great. I'm just filled with gratitude that you invited me to be on the program.
Yeah. Really?
Yeah. It's our boss program.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah, it is. It is. I'm just grateful to be here. It's an honor.
Thank you.
So, yeah.
Thank you, Michael. So we're opening by talking about something that you've been open about.
Yes.
I wonder what the feedback is typically like when, you know, someone as renowned as yourself uses that word with your name in the same sentence. Are people often surprised?
Very, very. because people have this impression that people living with depression, and I use living with and not suffering from.
Yes.
People living with depression, they think that they walk around with, you know, sad faces and they look miserable. And I tend to be a cheerful person most of the times.
But also this notion, Mike, that there's so many people walking around depressed and sad who are afraid to show it, to talk about it, because they have to wear that veneer that you speak about. Otherwise, it's stigma and shame.
That's true. And, you know, being a physician, you know, I always wanted to be a doctor. One of the main reasons is to help others. And I realized that when you have public figures who speak openly about these things, it empowers others to speak up or to get help. And this is a bit different from things like hypertension or diabetes. This is something that is stigmatized, that many people do not understand. And there are many people who suffer in silence. Some people don't even realize they have it.
Mm-hmm.
Some realize they have it, but they're afraid mm-hmm. to talk about it mm-hmm. or to seek help. And it's important for people to understand. It's like anything else, really. It's just like how I have asthma. It's a condition. I live with it. It does not define me as a person. So why not talk about that as well, you know?
I have depression.
Yeah.
I live with it. It doesn't define me as a person.
No, it does not. I tell people, this might sound strange, but I tell people that I'm actually grateful that I live with it.
Mm-hmm.
And it may sound strange to you, but the reason is that as a physician, I have a different level of empathy when I deal with people who have it.
Because
mm-hmm. I'm a gynecologist, but I'm male. So if a woman has something like fibroids, I can empathize with her to a point, because I've read about fibroids, I've done surgery and taken them out. I know what it's like, so I can understand that to a certain level. But if someone comes to me and they have depression, you know, or I diagnose them with it, my level of empathy is totally different.
Because you've been there.
Yeah, and the thing is that when I talk to them about it and I'm open, they don't feel judged.
Right.
Because this thing is very stigmatized. So for example, if they go to a doctor and a doctor says, you have depression, go and seek help, they might think, this doctor thinks I'm crazy and wow. You know, but there's no judgment.
Mm-hmm.
And people understand, yeah, this person understands what I'm dealing with.
And largely, I mean, you've seen in your practice that a lot of the people who come to you with illnesses, like physical illnesses, are manifesting symptoms of the depression or traumatic events in their lives that they've been through. Because as you tell me, Mike, something that stood with me since we spoke, your body is keeping the score.
Yes, I'm reading a book now titled The Body Keeps the Score. It's a great book. And the title says it all. So when you have trauma or you've survived trauma or you may have other things that are affecting or causing you stress, the body actually can respond with physical symptoms. And there's something interesting about our population, because diseases and disorders present differently sometimes depending on the ethnicity of the patients or geographic location. And what research has found is that in this country, people with depression often present with something we call somatization, which means physical manifestations.
Mm-hmm.
It's very interesting. So some people may, for example, they present with persistent back pain or lower abdominal pain, or they have chest pain, chest tightness, indigestion. They have multiple symptoms sometimes. And when you get to the bottom of it, what they really have is depression.
Christ.
And it can manifest in that way. And it can manifest, people think depression is only manifested with or by, you know, a low mood, people being sad. But sometimes it can be manifested as anger, rage. And people need to understand that, especially in our society. So some of these people you see who are miserable, angry, always hitting out, some of them are hurting inside. Some of them may have depression and mm-hmm. they really need a hug.
Oh,
but you have to be careful to approach them still, because they're
true.
Malicious too. But some of them need a hug, you know.
No, but this is important to set up where we're going with this program. And that is also very instructive. I think light bulb just went off in a lot of people's heads. Let's talk a little bit about when you were able to diagnose your mood, quote unquote, yes. When you never knew what it was. That was when you were in university. But you grew up in a home where there was, you had your mom, you had your dad.
Yes.
But there was a lot of, is it fair to say, a lot of anger, misplaced anger?
There was a lot of that, really. It's weird. I tell people I grew up in a nuclear family. Because when my dad lost his temper, it was like a nuclear explosion. But it's kind of interesting because looking back, knowing what I know now, I understand my father and my mom. One thing I can tell people, I know my parents loved me. There's no question about that. I never felt unloved. But looking back, I realized that there was some torment with my dad, you know? And I know my mom had a lot of anxiety issues mm-hmm. as well. I could tell that now, looking back. And you know, at the time, I didn't have as much insight into human behavior or interest, really. Mm-hmm. But looking back, I understand a lot of things now. And rather than feeling resentful or angry, I love my parents, man.
Mm-hmm. They're both.
And I'm grateful that I don't have any lingering resentments. When I think about them, I don't feel angry or bad.
Because you
or
said
anything.
You were able to forgive your dad, but you got a lot of licks.
No, my dad, let me tell you.
You get regular.
My father did not speak about his childhood. So I don't know anything about his childhood, his family, whatever. But I know, looking back, there must have been some dysfunction there because he my father, on one hand, was very kind. And he was very loving and very affectionate. So my father would kiss me. But on the other hand, when he lost it, you just don't want to be there. You know, you just don't want to be around. And unfortunately, the go-to punishment for my dad, for my mom, my grandmother, my mother's mom, it was corporal punishment. So they all used corporal punishment.
Beaten.
Yeah. And it's common in our society. It's not unusual, really. Mm-hmm. It's not. But there comes a point where when it's done a lot, especially when you have audiences watching it.
Because you got beaten at home.
Yeah.
You get beaten at school.
All over
you
the
get
place.
Beaten on the road.
Yeah, roadside. Classroom full of children, in front of the garden outside, visitors to the house. The only place left was to get beaten at stadium. There's a whole heap of audience. So it's kind of weird because my dad, on the other hand, I was always a studious child.
Mm-hmm.
I do my exams and pass, and he would ask me, how well did you do? How much did you come in the class? And I wasn't very competitive. I'd say, well, I passed. And he would tell me that I don't have the killer instinct, and he was upset about that. But it's hard to have a killer instinct when you get beaten a lot because that will erode your self-confidence, you know?
Yeah.
So it's interesting looking back, knowing what I know now.
All right, we'll talk with Mike Moore when we come back. Stay with us, everybody. All right, back with Mike, everybody. We're picking up when you were growing up, Michael. So your sense of self, your self-confidence, your self-esteem was all wrapped up in what was happening? Or is it safe to say that you were able to eke out a sense of self even while that was going on?
Yes, just that my self-esteem, looking back, it wasn't what it ought to have been. Yeah.
And you would really find this out in sixth form, right?
Yeah, I found this out. The first inkling of it was when I was in high school and I was in sixth form. I was a good kid. I didn't give trouble and I did my work. And I remember it was either the principal or the dean of discipline said to me, look, you know, something to the effect of you'd be the obvious choice for a head boy, but you lack the self-confidence to do it. And it made sense because I had basically very little. And you have to have some kind of leadership skills or self-confidence if you're going to be a head boy.
Mm-hmm.
And I was disappointed. But again, I understand.
Was that a revelation for you or did you know all along?
I think that was the first time it really occurred to me that...
Like in your face?
Yeah. Yeah.
And the fact that you knew it, but then it was clear to you now that other people were seeing it.
Yes.
Epiphany.
Yeah, right? I guess you could call it that.
So how does a young man who is having esteem issues, now decide he wants to go to medical school?
No, I always wanted to be a doctor. That was a given. From as far back as I can remember, always wanted to be a doctor. Always. I had this fascination with science, and I had this desire to help people get better.
Mm-hmm.
So the combination of the two. So that was always what I wanted to be.
Tell
always.
Me about the moment in med school that you realized that you were diagnosable, or when you realized what you had.
That was from a little before, yeah. Because you know, my mood does get very low. I'd feel very sad a lot of the time, and I'd be like, you know, this is not normal. It's not normal.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm grateful that that kind of stigma did not stop me from getting help.
Mm-hmm.
Because I look on it like anything else.
So
if I'm having shortness of breath, I know I need to see the doctor about this. Toothache, I need to see the dentist. My mood isn't so good. No, I need to sort myself out. See somebody in mental health, a psychiatrist, psychologist, whatever it is, you know, and deal with this, because I don't want anything to be a barrier to my progress. I'm a very, very driven person, though. That's one thing.
That's a paradox I couldn't understand.
Yeah, I'm extremely driven. So I don't want anything in my way that I can do something about to remain in my way.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm grateful that I had that kind of insight back then, because it made a huge difference.
Mm-hmm. So when you were diagnosed, how did you feel, Mike?
Just one of those things. It's just, okay, I have asthma. I have this, deal with it, and just keep it moving. Keep it moving. Why not? As I said, it doesn't define me as a person.
Mm-hmm.
I just realize, I have this, and I wonder, and then as I got older and look back, I kind of realize where it may have been coming from, because depression and anxiety are very closely linked.
Yes.
You know, I have features of both. And looking back, my mother's mother, my grandmother, one of the first drugs I ever knew about was Valium. She was always taking Valium. And
tell us what Valium is.
It's something, you know, it's used for anxiety. Mm-hmm. I shouldn't say used for anxiety. Many persons with anxiety take drugs like that, but it should not be taken long-term. And it's a sedative,
mm-hmm.
you know, it's something that is used short-term. And I remember her taking it. I remember looking back, my grandmother was always the kind of person who didn't want to have any trouble with anybody, didn't, you know, I don't want to have any trouble. And looking back, I remember my mom was kind of that way as well. So looking back, I think there may have been a genetic component. And looking back at my childhood, I know there's a socialization component, you know, nature and nurture.
Mm-hmm.
But it is what it is. You just understand, okay, that's where it's coming from.
Yeah.
So I need to sort
and for
that
you,
out.
That's like great, because you like to understand why things are the way they are.
I have this desire to understand.
Right.
So I feel this way. Why do I feel this way? Okay, I understand where it's coming from. And understand what to do about it. And I also understand that I have to break the cycle. You know, I have to, because I know better now.
Mm-hmm.
And going back to the corporal punishment thing, it's something that is interwoven into our society. And it's interesting how socialization can fix things in your head. And the fact is that probably most people in this country receive corporal punishment. And many people will say, well, I got it.
I got beaten and nothing wrong with
I
me.
I got it and I turn out okay.
Yeah.
And the answers to that, you know, are, okay, first of all, if you turned out okay, good for you. But that does not mean it's a good thing.
And what about the people who did not?
Yeah, someone could say, I drink 10 rum and coke every Friday night and race my friend to Mobe. And you never crash. Good for you. But that's not a good thing. The second thing is, you may think you're okay, but you're not okay. I'm sure you know people, probably even at your workplace where you work, who think they're okay and you know that something is off with that person, but they don't have the insight. And some people will say, well, I'm glad I got beaten because it kept me out of trouble. But again, research, data, facts. In this country, everybody who is in prison for murder in Jamaica now received corporal punishment as a child. So that argument, not a really very valid argument. And we need to have more conversations about this, because people will say, well, it's part of our culture. And just because something is part of your culture doesn't mean it's
a good thing.
It's a good thing.
I want to talk to you about how you managed it, because you say, or how you're managing it, because it's something you still live with every day, but you say you've become really good and managing it. And that bit of what you share can be very helpful to somebody else. Yeah. So stick around, more with Michael when we come back. Back with Dr. Michael Abrams is talking to us about his struggles with depression and how he's now at a place where he's learned to live with it because he manages it so well. So what does that management look like, Michael?
As I said before, it's a good thing it was addressed early. Addressed early means, you know, you go for, after being diagnosed, you go on medication and then you understand the value of therapy. And some people will say, well, what is a therapist going to tell me that I don't know? And I tell people, listen, if somebody spends years at a tertiary level institution and has a degree in psychology, they must know something that you don't know. And I'm open-minded enough and humble enough to accept that. So, you know, you go to therapy and you learn how to cope with certain things. You learn where certain things are coming from.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm at this place now where I can tell people, that's why I use the word, I live with it. It's something that's there, but to be honest, nowadays it's really not so bad because I've learned to manage it. It's really not so bad, but it's something that I'm just aware of.
Mm-hmm. And that management
it's a journey though. It's a journey.
It includes like when you feel it coming, do you like welcome it? You say, hi, I know this, I know what you are, but I know I've been here before and I know I'm gonna be okay.
Yeah, because I know what it is and I tell people, depression is like wearing a pair of glasses with very, very dark lenses. Lenses that are very dark, dirty, cracked, and distorted. So you put them on, you get a very distorted view of what is going on. But that's not the reality of life. So when my mood becomes like that, I'm always reminded that this isn't really how life really is, man. It's just that feeling you might get, and it will pass, and it always passes. Am I at that place? No. You know, back then it was much, much, much harder to deal with.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm at that place now. Mm-hmm. So when I meet people now who are at the place I was many years ago, I can look in their face and say, yeah, I understand what that is. And I can list out all the symptoms. I know how you feel. I really, really understand how you feel.
But you know what the important part of what you said is?
Yes.
The it will pass part. Because right. That's a part when you're in the thick of it that people don't realize because you don't feel like you'll ever get out.
I'm speaking for myself, but for me, at the place where I am now, but for some people, it may not, especially people who don't seek help. And there are different levels of severity.
Right.
You have mild, moderate, and when it gets, some people will think, for example, if you mention a disease like cancer or heart disease, people will think, man, that's not good, man, that could kill you. But many people don't think that depression can kill you. And it can, because many persons with depression end up being suicidal and they commit suicide.
Sir. Yes, sir.
That's a real problem.
Yes, sir.
So it's something that is to be taken seriously. And many people who don't get help just live being tormented.
Mm-hmm. Meditation has helped you?
Yes. It's a game changer. It changed my life, really.
We talk about it and people every day. Think it's hairy-fairy, but no, it's really important.
All right, so I'm a fan of evidence, facts, data, research.
Yeah.
And I used to hear about meditation a lot. I never really paid much attention to it. And then I decided, I saw an app being advertised on my iPhone. The app is called FitMind. And the tagline was, rewire your brain or rewire your mind. And I thought, that's an interesting concept, to rewire. And I started looking at the research on meditation, real research. You know, Harvard, Johns Hopkins, and if you meditate regularly, it literally changes your mind, and it also changes your brain physically. So when they do scans on persons who meditate regularly, there's a part of your brain called the amygdala, and that mm-hmm. part is concerned with fear and anxiety. And when somebody overreacts to something and freaks out, that's the amygdala working. The prefrontal cortex is another part of your brain that's more concerned with cognitive and rational thinking. And I find that when people meditate regularly, after 2 months or more, the amygdala literally starts to shrink and the prefrontal cortex thickens.
I need to meditate.
So I look on it as taming the amygdala then.
Gotcha.
You tame it.
And you've also changed in other ways, not just in meditation, but you're at a better place now in terms of opinions, public or otherwise. You said that growing up, you think your trauma response was fawning. You told me there was fear, fight, flight, freeze, and fawn.
Yes.
And you were a fawner because you liked to keep the peace, conflict, deflection. So you would always people please and agree and for the sake of no, especially after having been thrust into the public, you know, domain and with all these opinions coming at you about who you are and what you say, you just have to get to a point where you just didn't care.
I didn't know when I reached here, because even talking about this on a program like this now, many years ago, I wouldn't do it. I would think, what would people think of me if I do this and whatever, and I don't care anymore now, because I realize that this may empower even one person watching this. Even one person. It has the potential to save even one person's life. Somebody living on the edge thinking, man, if he has it and he can be on a, you know, like this and living a normal life and being productive, there's hope for me then.
Yeah. When you just kind of stepped out publicly, was it difficult to get used to? You know, so often the backlash
it's
that
weird.
Would come from you.
Let me tell you, you said something earlier that I wanted to go back to. So many people know that when you're faced with trauma, there's this response called a fight or flight response. So for example, you hear a gunshot and somebody runs in here with a gun, your heart races because your adrenaline goes up, your heart races to pump blood which carries oxygen to your muscles to fight or run. Although some people freeze.
Mm-hmm.
And there's another trauma response called fawning. That's when you fawn because you don't want any trouble. So you agree, I just want to be a people pleaser. Mm-hmm. You want to please everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how much of my life was spent like that. I did not even realize it was a trauma response until relatively recently that it's a trauma response because you want to avoid conflict because the consequences of conflict from childhood were getting some big lick or humiliation. So you don't want that. So you say, okay, man, I agree. Everything is okay, man. I try to please everybody. And there came a point where I realized this is destructive. You will never please everybody, ever. And I think about two figures in history, Jesus Christ and Adolf Hitler. Jesus Christ was the bomb. Adolf Hitler was disgusting. And both of those men had many people who loved them and many people who hated them.
Mm-hmm.
So no matter what you do, so just be yourself. As long as you try not to hurt other people.
Right.
You understand?
Right.
So relatively recently, I realized that the fawning thing was a trauma response, which really fascinated me.
Wow.
So I'm still learning about myself.
Yeah, well, you know, that's a good thing, is to be a student of life and student of yourself. We all can be a little more self-aware and make ourselves better. All right, it's time for our good vibes for you, sir. Let's have a look at that, and then we'll come back and talk some more with Mike on the back end. Go ahead, Lore.
Bonanos, Mike! You are so loved. You are one of the best people I have ever met in my life, bar none. Your caring, compassionate heart is something that separates you from the rest. And the way you care for everyone else and give and give and give from a place not expecting anything in return. Hey, them something not normal, you know. You're not normal, smaddy. And I consider it an honor to call you friend. May you continue to know how wonderful you are. And may the love that you give to others be returned to you 1,000-fold.
Michael Abrams, you know the respect tall up, right? Like way up. Yes, way up, my general. And I'm so happy I got the opportunity to say this to you on this platform because, Michael, you are a really great human being. I love the fact that you champion so many causes. You are a warrior for people who don't have a voice, and you take on issues that affect us all, but you do it with a certain level of passion and commitment that is admirable. And so my brethren, Michael, my comedic brethren, you know, we miss you on the comedy stage, but I get to talk to you one way and reason with you about many other things. And you've always been generous with information, with nuggets, with just being there as a brethren for me. And I want to say thank you very much on behalf of my family to yours. We love you, Mikey. Big up yourself every time.
I'm here to let you know how much I truly appreciate our friendship. You've been there for me in so many ways. I've texted you, I've called you a million times, and you're always there for me. And somehow I know that I'm not the only person who can say that, because that's just the type of man that you are. A wonderful human being. Thank you for your heart, your brains, the light that you shine, the fire where you blaze. It's a necessary illumination, and I appreciate you so much.
You just love people, and you love what you do, and you always want to make a difference, and that is what I admire about you. And if you love people, you love Jamaican people, you love this nation, and I know that in your heart, you want so much that is good for this nation, and you wish you could do it all yourself. Unfortunately, you can't, but you inspire some of us to do more than we have been doing. Enough love. And keep doing what you're doing. I wish I had a quarter of your creativity with all them teachers just write and rhyme and deliver some. Mercy, what good. Remember that?
In a world with so much instability, so much uncertainty, Michael, you are that constant. Your love, your encouragement, your support is unwavering. And that is something that we can always depend on. That remains constant. You have been immensely blessed from an early age to know exactly what your purpose in life is. And not only have you discovered that, you have also discovered what your superpower is, which is simply understanding the misunderstood.
And we talk about the chaos and mayhem of Spanish Town Hospital, and the every day, brother, are about singing the Whitney Houston song in a Bajan accent. I'm going to talk more about the love me have for my brethren. You came and sat with my mother while she was passing away, while I went to look drugs for her. You're my son's godfather. Man, you're closer than family to me. You're blood of my blood, flesh of my flesh. So that's why I say bless you. I wish all the prosperity, joy, health, and love that can come to any family, to come to you and yours, and to make you know that me and everybody else around the world, we love you, man. You're a good youth. You're all right.
Just sending you some love and all the respect that you so richly deserve, man. You know, I just want to let you know how much I love you and appreciate you, always.
Sending a shout out to you, Michael, thanking you for your heart of empathy, of love, of authenticity, and just wishing blessings of peace and love on you and your beloved family. Take care now.
I'm so grateful that over the last decade, we are friends. You know, I'm so grateful for the friendship that we've had over the last 10 years. It's been wonderful, not just being under your care, but also, you know, being on the receiving end of your love, your laughter. Oh, the laughter, the jokes are endless. Yes, it's jokes nonstop, but also your counsel. And, you know, just being able to walk into your office from time to time, or to pick up that phone from time to time just to talk to you, has meant so much in my life. I literally wouldn't have my little family without you. So we love you. We're so proud of you always. And we hope that you continue being exactly who you are, because the world needs you. Love you so much. Mwah.
Knowing you has been a life-changing experience for me, because you have shown me what it means to really love everybody. You love your patients. I mean, to the point where it is annoying. I'm the anesthetist. I have your phone. A million calls are coming in and I must answer everyone, because all your patients and everybody must know that you're not ignoring their calls, that you care enough to have somebody answer it. You are the essence of loyalty. All of those serious life issues that I've had to endure, you were always there supporting me. Mikey, this is just to say that I appreciate you and I love you too. Bless you.
You bring so much of a smile. You bring so much of a joy to your work and to your existence, to the point where a lot of times when I'm passing you in the corridor, pretty much what I feel like doing is busting out the laugh, because there's some mischief going on between me and you somewhere. So I really just want you to continue to be you, my resident office bromance, Just continue to be you. We love you and we value what you do, and don't stop doing it.
I know I've told you this a lot before, but I'm gonna make it public and tell you. I think you're one of the best writers, comedic satirists and humorists that Jamaica has ever produced. And I just wanted to tell you that keep doing what you're doing. No matter nobody let you down, get you down. One love, Mike. Miss you in the studio, brother. Blessings.
I'm sure the last several weeks and months have been just a roller coaster of emotions, lots of back and forth and touch and go. I won't pretend to fully understand what our little guy has been going through, what you all have been going through, but I am confident that you're doing what you can and what you must. I just want you to know that you have people in your corner that you can look to. So please, lean on us if things get too difficult or overwhelming, because we all just want you to keep on keeping on in peace, you know? So take care, and may every day be the best it can be.
I'll always be by your side, and I love you very much. I remember those days when we were young and having fun playing together, sharing laughter together. Those are memories that I will forever cherish.
I just wish you all the love, all the blessing, you know, as I say. Thank you for everything you've done for us and everything you keep doing for us. Just much love. Love you, Dad. It's your son, Zachary.
Hey, Daddy. I just want to say that I am incredibly grateful to have you as my father. And I love our relationship in that even though I'm older now, I don't ever feel as though I'm too big to come to you with any problem that I might have. Thank you very much for treating me the way that you have, for treating me so well. And yeah, I love you.
Hello, Daddy. I am sending this video to show you how much I love you. And I know you probably know this, but I love you infinity times.
A wonderful father. Don't know what would have been done without you. This year will be 19 years. 19 years of warmth and love and respect, and my cheerleader and supporting me and fighting for me. I know that if I had a bad day, I can always count on you, you know, to be there in my corner and to make things all better for me. And with that, I want to say I wish you all the best, honey. I'm there with you, behind you, beside you, wherever you want me to be. I'll be there to continue to love you and respect you, because you're such an awesome individual. So all the best, my darling, and I will see you soon.
That's your best friend.
Yes. Where dig up all them people from? Seriously.
Then do you mean dig up? What do you mean? They was buried? Come on, Mike.
I'm just speechless. I would say I'm speechless, but if I speak, I'm not speechless. But I love them all so much, you know, very. And I don't even know what to say. Everybody, I love them so much. And I feel their love, and I'm just appreciative. I live with gratitude.
Every day.
Yeah.
Lori, how much time do we have in this segment left? Londa, can you ask her for me? 1 minute. So I want to add my...
Sure.
Sentiment to the good vibes.
This is the part where you make me cry now. Okay.
Actually, I didn't know I was going to do this, and I didn't feel it until I just felt it. So I just realized, Mike, that there are two very pivotal points in my life in which you have been instrumental. The first is October 15, when I was in the hospital room at Andrews, waiting to have Aaron. I did not know you were a part of Dr. Brainford's team. I was my doctor at the time. And I was lying in the hospital bed, about to have my C-section, and this gentleman walks in with an iPod at the time. Is that what it used to be called?
Yes, yes.
And says, hi, I'm going to be in. And I was like, oh, my God. And he says to me, what music do you want to hear? And I said, Babyface. And he put it on, and he wheeled me downstairs, and... he was there when my child was born. And then the next one I remember, this is an amazing juxtaposition, is when I was pregnant the second time, and I came to you to have my first ultrasound. And the look on your face when you said to me, there is nothing there. I don't know if you remember that. It's something I will never forget. That was my first of three miscarriages, by the way, folks. I've spoken about it before. And how you talked me through that, in that moment, in that tragedy, I just want to say thank you for that. Because those words to hear are, I don't know like how I processed it, still processing it, but the gift you have of being able to just, you know, let people know that yesterday is a really bad day, but there are other good days ahead.
Yes.
And so I am grateful to you for that.
Man, that just blindsided me, man.
Well, it blindsided me too, but when I feel these things nowadays, I just talk it because I don't know how long I'm going to be here. And I need for you to know.
Hey, you're very welcome.
So now you know.
Thanks. This means a lot to me.
All right. Sorry, I have to go there. We're back after this. All right, guys. So Mike says there are two things in his life he's particularly grateful for. One is his diagnosis of depression. The other is divorce in his first marriage because they both taught you very valuable life lessons.
Yes.
And one thing you have taken from both those things is gratitude. And
definitely.
So you now live your life every day. So when people call you, you say, I'm alive and grateful.
Yes.
And that's how you approach everything.
Yes.
Yeah. Talk to us about that and how we can all live from that prison.
A patient gave me a plaque that's in my office and it says, life doesn't have to be perfect to be beautiful or wonderful. And
yeah,
I live by that because nothing is ever perfect. So sometimes I will hear people say, I'm a perfectionist, and they say it with pride. And I will say that's not really a good thing because nothing is perfect. But I'm just grateful for everything that I have and that I have experienced. I have this principle that in science, energy can neither be created nor destroyed.
Yes.
But it can be converted from one type to another.
Yes.
And that's what I try to do with negative experiences. So, for example, I was married before. So my daughter is from my first marriage. And people might think it's weird that I say I'm grateful that I've experienced that divorce because that was one of the most painful things I've ever experienced. But I'm grateful, not only because I learned a lot, but because when I have patients again who are going through that, my level of empathy is totally different. It can be very hard for some people to understand what it's like for a marriage to end. You know, some people can be very flippant about it. You know, get down, just leave then. It's not like that. You know, because the day you go into a church with someone and you have a ceremony and you get married, splitting up is the last thing on your mind.
Of course.
You think this is it.
Of course.
And I'm in this thing.
Of course.
So. Energy conversion, I deal with that. So whatever negative stuff I've experienced, I try to make something positive out of it.
Boy, we are glad you live like that because you inspire the rest of us to know that, you know, bad things happen to good people and vice versa. But once you keep trucking and try to have an attitude of gratitude, you can get through.
Definitely, because it's an interesting concept again.
Last point, because we have to go to affirmation. Yes.
I was saying that sometimes people will tell me that they go through bad thing experiences and they go through periods where they're angry with God. Many people think I'm an atheist. I'm not. I believe there's a God. I'm just not religious. And I tell people, listen, I have no reason to be angry with God because he doesn't know me anything. You know, things happen. You just have to deal with it. I don't think I've earned any exemption from trauma or stress or crosses. Mm-hmm. So you just deal with it and keep it moving and enjoy life as much as you can.
Mm-hmm.
And try to bring joy to others.
And try to bring joy to others. Thank you, Mike.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Really appreciate you being here. Okay, now it's time for affirmation, everybody. Okay, so life is not perfect. Nothing ever is. But how good is it to know that life doesn't have to be perfect to be beautiful? And that being alive and grateful can change our outlook, which can then change our lives. Focusing on what we're grateful for can lengthen our lives and increase the quality of it too. And it doesn't mean you walk around as if nothing's wrong, you know, I'm good all the time. No, it just means we understand that things will happen that will knock us down, but that once we can look up, we can get up. Stay down a little bit if you must, rest if you need to, but please get back up and take deliberate steps to living your best gratitude-filled, imperfectly beautiful life. Tonight we affirm, I will appreciate the beauty in life's blemishes and embrace them for the better. That is our soul food and our show for this evening. Thank you for watching. We'll be here next week with another story of the power of the human spirit. Our season finale next week. You don't want to miss it, everybody. Until then, every blessing, and please remember to count your blessings.